We'll go to the block number two, the opportunities in the agri-food, horticulture and logistics sector of the Mekong Delta. And for that, I would like to give the floor to Siebe van Wijk. Siebe, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Luke. Good morning in the Netherlands and good evening in Southeast Asia. A few months ago, the Dutch Agriculture Council in Vietnam asked me to share my experiences as Dutch entrepreneur in the Mekong Delta. And that's what I'm going to present to you about the opportunities which there are. Next slide, please. So I'll start briefly to give a background about myself and Fresidio. Then I'll show you the enormous successful rise of Vietnam, the changes that happened in the Mekong Delta, but then also all the work that still needs to be done. And I will use the biggest sector in the Mekong Delta, the shrimp sector, as an example. Based on that example, we'll look at business opportunities which there are in the other sectors. Next slide. I'm an agriculture economist from Wageningen University, and I started to work in Vietnam from 2001. And moved there in 2004. Together with my partner Irma Manting, we founded Fresidio in 2006, and then later set up an office in Dalat in Ho Chi Minh City in Cam Thu. So for the past 15 years, I've had the opportunity to live in all the key areas of Vietnam. With Fresidio, I've been working on many agriculture subsectors, but we never had a client which was interested in fruit, and that's why we decided to start a second company called the Fruit Republic, which over time developed into one of the leading fruit and vegetable producers and exporters in the domestic market. Next slide. Fresidio is a consulting and R&D firm, and we help our clients in the sustainable production and marketing of food. We have offices four in Vietnam, an R&D farm in Vietnam, and a few years ago we opened an office in Yangon. Most of our projects are multidisciplinary, so that's why we have a multidisciplinary team of consultants, 60 staff, who can give advice on every step on the chain. Next slide. The rise of Vietnam. When I came to Vietnam the first time was 2001, before I'd worked mostly in East Africa. And then Vietnam was quite a different experience. There was a lot of entrepreneurship in the country. I mean, the agriculture sector in either East Africa or Southeast Asia, I mean, farmers everywhere in the world are hardworking and quite entrepreneurial, but there was much more happening in the country. Next slide. In 1990, the GDP was just 6.5 billion, and the Dutch economy at that time was about 50 times larger than the Vietnamese economy. Now in 2019, the gap between the Netherlands and Vietnam, still the Dutch economy is larger, but it's only three times compared to 50 times in 1990. So Vietnam has had one of the fastest growing economy for the past 30 years of all countries in the world. Normally China and India get all the attention, and few people know that here's a country with close to 100 million people developing very well. Next slide. When I came to Vietnam in 2001, there was just an export value of $15 billion, and the imports were more or less the same. It was a negative trade balance. Vietnam joined WTO in 2007, which at first led to more negative trade balance, but over time, Vietnam is now having a positive trade balance. And quite a diversified economy. The Vietnamese economy is very open, which I'll show you in the next slide. First, in agriculture exports, Vietnam really has become an agriculture powerhouse. In a lot of commodities, especially, Vietnam is in the top three producers in the world. Cashew nuts is number one, frozen fish fillets, it's number two, rice is number three in the world, coffee is number three in the world, shrimps is number four, in fruit, pitahaya, it's number one, rubber, it's a world player. So, and this all happened in a period of just 20 years, and almost all of this development was done by smallholder farmers. The average farm size in Vietnam is just half a hectare. And for all these commodities, they are coming from the millions and millions of smallholders. Next slide. There did not only happen a lot on the exports, also a lot happened on the imports. And that also will give you a bit of an idea that, well, they're producing a lot of crops and livestock, but what inputs are they using for it? If you, for example, look at pesticides on the graph on the left, you see that in 2001, Vietnam imported just around $100 million of pesticides. But now in 2019, Vietnam is importing almost $1 billion of pesticides. So to give you a reference, Vietnam exports of rice is about $1 billion. And that's already being offset with all the imports just for pesticides alone. But also fertilizers imports increase a lot. But in the past few years, more and more fertilizer companies were set up in Vietnam. So more and more of the production is domestic. But also agriculture machinery, all these things are upcoming. If you look to the livestock-related inputs, it's even more dramatic what has happened. Corn imports from just a few million dollars to more than $2 billion of imports. Also in antibiotics, you've seen an enormous increase. Next slide. Besides inputs, Vietnam is also importing a lot of food. So Vietnam is also an interesting market destination for producers from all over the world. 10 years ago, you could hardly find an apple in the supermarkets. Now, the shelf space to apples is enormous. Also, products like grapes and other fruits are really growing very, very fast. You see cashew nuts. Hey, Vietnam is one of the biggest exporters of cashew nuts. How can it be such a big importer? More than $1 billion of cashew nuts imports. This is related that Vietnam imports a lot of cashew nuts raw material out of mostly Africa, and then they process it in Vietnam and then re-export. You also see this happening in shrimps. So Vietnam is a big shrimp exporter, but they don't have enough shrimps themselves. So they're importing a lot of shrimps out of India, especially, and then process it in Vietnam and then re-export it. Next slide. So that's a general picture of how dynamic the Vietnamese economy is. And I think that's a very important factor for entrepreneurs, Dutch entrepreneurs, if they want to decide to invest in Vietnam. Now let's zoom in on the Mekong Delta. Next slide. Mekong Delta is more or less the same size as the Netherlands, which is the main city, Kanteur, about 4 million hectares, but with a big difference from the Netherlands, 73% of the population is still rural. The size of the Mekong Delta economy is about 40% of the national GDP. Next slide. The Mekong Delta is very, very important for the Vietnamese agriculture sector. Almost 60% of Vietnamese rice production comes from the Mekong Delta. For aquaculture, 70% of the production of Vietnam is originating from the Mekong Delta. Fruits, 40%, vegetables, 25%, livestock is smaller. So we saw in the previous presentation from Ian that the Mekong Delta should switch more from rice to other crops, but farmers already have been doing that enormously. Next slide. If you look at for example, rice, the area of rice, the harvested area was growing until 2000, let's say 12, 14, and after that the area has gone down. First of all, farmers are switching more and more to other crops. So even in a province of Dong Thap, which is kind of was in the previous presentation shown that that should have a rice focused orientation. There you see a lot of farmers now switching from rice to fruits. Also aquaculture, there's an enormous increase. I'll go into that detail later. Fruits just developed from around 100,000 hectare to already 300,000 hectare. Livestock, there is some development in the Mekong Delta, mostly in poultry and pigs, but there's more growth happening in other areas in poultry and pigs than in the Mekong Delta. Next slide. Challenges, I'll not go into much detail there because the previous presentation already spoke about it. Salinity intrusion, very, very big issue, especially in the dry season. So let's say from January till May in the dry season, with the pressure from land going down, sea level going up, and less water coming through the Mekong rivers because more and more dams are being built in China and in neighboring countries like Laos. And this is a big problem in the dry season. Next slide. Now I'm going to zoom in on shrimp farming. Next slide. Just take a look at these numbers. If you compare the total aquaculture production in the Netherlands with Vietnam in 2000, it was on par. But then 20 years later, the shrimp production in Vietnam has grown to more than 600,000 ton, generating $3.3 billion and employing more than almost 1 million people in the rural areas, but also employing a lot of people in the factories. There are 500 processing factories in the Mekong Delta, and this also explains why they're importing a lot of raw material, because they cannot get enough out of the Mekong Delta. They're even importing volume out of India. Next slide. A lot of the shrimp farming grows in production is yes, by opening more shrimp farms, but at the same time also the farming systems have changed. On the left picture you see a mangrove shrimp farm, which is more or less farmers were trapping shrimps there and then waiting for them to be harvested, resulting in about, you know, half a ton of per hectare per year. And this was not giving people enough income, so they started to intensify, where they're now producing 650 tons per hectare per year. And you see that on the picture on the right. Next slide. This was all going quite well until, let's say, from 2010 of a peak per productivity of about, this is the average, about 5 tons per hectare, when a lot of shrimp mysteriously started to die and before they were at the right size, so-called early mortality syndrome. Next slide. Yes. So you see that based on our calculations, if they would have developed a sustainable shrimp farming system, which could have stayed at the same level as 2010, there would have been more than $3 billion of marketable shrimps, and Vietnam would have not have to rely on imports from other countries. Next slide. Well, the Vietnamese farmers are very entrepreneurial, very innovative. So they were not just waiting and seeing what were happening. They're trying to really innovate. So one of the things they did was covering the pond, so there was less sunshine, so there will be less growth of algae in the pond. They put in pedal wheels to put in oxygen and even more modern aeration systems. They set up sludge removal so that the water quality would be better, and they started to invest in automated feeders. Next slide. But we also believe that there's still a lot that can be done. And one of the things that we as Fresidio have been doing with our aquaculture team and several of our partners is to develop a low-cost pond cleaning device, which could be used by smallholder farmers. This machine filters the water, adds oxygen, so that it's almost like a floating lung for the farmer. So if he has an area of a pond of 1,000 square meter, this device will give him the same results as if he would have 2,000 square meter. We have developed it, tested it, so we're at the prototype phase, and we're now trying to bring it to the next stage, where we can produce more of these devices and see if we can develop a kind of an access to finance model where smaller farmers could lease such a device and help to improve their productivity in a more sustainable way. Next slide. Business opportunities in the Mekong Delta. I think tomorrow will be, you see a big feed factory of De Heus in the Mekong Delta. Tomorrow there'll be a presentation by the host about their experiences. Next slide. But whatever sector you look in the Mekong Delta, they're all the same kind of issues, and at the same time this means opportunities if you can provide solutions. Vietnamese farmers use too much of all inputs. It was quite a change for me when I came from East Africa, where always the issue was there was not enough nutrients being added to the farming system. It was all about negative nutrient balances. In Vietnam, for sure, it's the other way around. There's far too much an unbalanced fertilizer use, which is costing a lot of money. There's too much pesticides in a non-rational way, too much water, too much feed in the animal sector, too much antibiotics, and lack of good genetics. A lot of the input companies and technology companies are purely sales driven, organizing parties with the farmers, drinking beer with them, and then trying to push sales very aggressively. Instead of helping farmers, giving them good advice, so that in the end they will keep using your input in your technology. A lot of the inputs and technology and solutions that are being provided to farmers are very short term. Next slide. So we believe that there's a lot of interesting business opportunity in inputs and technologies in the Mekong Delta, but you need to take the Vietnamese farmer very serious. It's a big potential market. Yes, they're small, but they're entrepreneurial. If the Vietnamese farmers see the value added and have done their farm economic calculation, which they do, and they see the result is good, and normally they will calculate with a payback period of just 2 years. They're not going to wait 6 years to see an impact. But if you have that, you have a big potential market. But it requires you to undertake applied R&D. Be sure what your value added is. Train your staff, focus on providing the farmers the best advice, not focusing on your short-term sales. Set up demonstration farms, link farmers to the change. And quite some Dutch companies have been doing it successfully in Vietnam. Later, Maaike from Isessies will tell more about it. They have been one of the first who are doing applied R&D, developing technologies for farmers in the Mekong Delta very successfully. But also companies like De Heus, and also Bayo, another seed company, Nutreco, Skretting, Rexvaan. These are all Dutch companies which in the past 2 years are seeing the potential of Vietnam, investing in Vietnam, and taking all the above steps. Next slide. So there are a lot of business opportunities along the chain, not only on the input side, where I've just given some examples. But if you look in aquaculture, there are very few professional hatcheries, nurseries. Also in the fruit sector, there's 300,000 hectares of fruits, but there's no professional nursery. Most farmers, after 2 years, 30% of their fruit trees die. So there is a lot of political emphasis on, yes, we need to develop fruit value chains in the Mekong Delta, but how to do that? And one of the things where we need to start will be with good nurseries. Also further down the chain in processing, distribution and logistics, I'm very much looking forward to plans from Royal Haskoning to have a container terminal in the Mekong Delta, because now around 100,000 containers, although Ian mentioned that containerization is not yet so far, but already 100,000 containers per year of seafood and fruits are moving out of the Mekong Delta, driven straight through Ho Chi Minh City to Cat Lai Port or Cai Mep. How great would it be if we could just put the container on board in Kanto, and from there we go directly to Singapore and from there to Rotterdam. This was my presentation. If you want to know more, you can always contact me about the opportunities that are along the chain in the Mekong Delta. Thank you.
Thank you, Sieben, for your introduction, a very interesting introduction, and it gives a good view also with your own experiences in the Vietnam area. So I think it gives a good opportunity for the cooperation between the Dutch farmers and the Vietnamese farmers. And what you said, I think it's very interesting, and it gives very good opportunities for improve the position and the production of the agriculture and horticultural sector in Vietnam, and especially in the Mekong Delta.